everyone. Thank you very much for coming. I think we'll start. Sorry, it's a little bit late. A very warm welcome to all of you to the Forgiveness Project's fourth annual lecture. And it's a real honor today to have Professor Simon Baron-Cohen, who's going to be presenting some of his latest research and understanding on the subject of empathy. And we've also got two people who are going to share some of their personal stories. That's what we like to do at the Forgiveness Project. And that's Mary Foley and Peter Woolf, both of whom are closely involved in the Forgiveness Project and have worked on our Restore Prison program for a number of years. And while I have to bring sincere apologies from Fergal Keane, who was supposed to be chairing tonight, but he was called away to a foreign assignment, perhaps not unsurprisingly, we're very lucky to have Simon Fanshawe here, who has stood in at the very last minute, and we're very grateful. Simon has been described as a provocateur with a purpose, and he is also a one-time stand-up comedian. He founded one of the founders of Stonewall, and he's a broadcaster, and he also works in diversity. And quite apart from that, he's one of our esteemed patrons. So we're incredibly grateful to you, Simon, for standing in, and indeed to all the speakers tonight. So in January, it's going to be 10 years since the launching of the F Word exhibition. And then the charity was founded just very shortly after that. And it's extraordinary to me that we're here, because I never set out to start a charity. As a journalist, I was compelled to collect stories about forgiveness and reconciliation at a time when the rhetoric was really about revenge and retaliation. And I was really carried along with this sort of current of overwhelming interest that seemed to come from all around the world. And that's really why we're here today. The Forgiveness Project seems to tap into this deep public feeling that there is an alternative to conflict and the sort of disengagement that you see all around you. And tapping into this alternative seems to bring huge rewards, both in society and personally. So I'm not going to talk too much about the Forgiveness Project, but I just wanted to share a few little highlights of the last 12 years, just to give you a flavor of what we've been up to. So in October last year, we presented our research into the Restore program, which was undertaken by the Forensic Psychological Services at Middlesex University, and it was an evaluation. And we were really encouraged by the results, and it's very 3 days, so it's a very short, intense intervention. The researchers found that we had a very positive impact on the way offenders thought about offending, and this was really encouraging. For some, it was sudden and dramatic, and for others, it sowed seeds of new reflective behavior. We've been working on a new schools resource. That's going to be trialed. It is being trialed at the moment by teachers, and it's going to be launched before the end of the year. We've had three exhibitions. We've had loads of exhibitions, but three internationally, one in France and Sweden and in Kenya, where four editions, actually, with new stories, Kenyan stories, toured before the elections this year, and really, I think, produced a counter-narrative to that of ethnic violence. We presented at the UN, and there's a film that we're involved with, connected with, called Beyond Right and Wrong, that was shown. We ran our second diploma course, and the third one is going to be starting in January. Assisted Dr. Massey Noor, who's a senior lecturer at Canterbury Christchurch University, who I think hears today, in creating something called, it's an online resource called the Forgiveness Toolbox, which we're just launching, which is really exciting. There's leaflets, by the way, about all these things, about the diploma and about the toolbox, and also the film is for sale afterwards, just by the bar, so you're very welcome to come and look at that. And we've also been working with PA Consulting, the management consultancy, because it seems there's a real appetite to explore narrative, collective narrative and personal narrative in the workplace. So, and then there's much more. And also, just finally, I want to say that this year we had a great change. Angie Kotler joined us as the managing director. And Angie's had many years' experience as an educator, and she started her own charity, and she brings some really valuable new expertise to the organisation. So that's very exciting. And just finally, I just wanted to do a public thank you to the Winston Churchill Memorial Trust, because I was personally really lucky to win one of their fellowships this year. And that's great. You know, that's like a bursary, and I can travel for a month, and I'm going to go to America and Canada, and I'm going to look at offender programs that use restorative approaches. So I'm now going to hand over to Simon Fanshawe, our chair for the evening, and once again, very warm welcome to all of you.
Thank you, Marina, and a very warm... Huge thanks to Marina, both for the work that she's done over the 10 years, but also I would say personally, I would want to thank her for the way in which she introduced and has certainly kept my interest and personal commitment to this alive. So it's a great honour to be a patron, and thank you for asking me to do that. I won't speak for very long, and this is informal tonight, and there won't be any feedback. There'll be your questions, but no dreadful feedback forms. I did a conference recently, and there was a pile of them, and I looked, and somebody had written next door to my name, "If I only had an hour left to live in my life, I'd want to spend it listening to a speech by Simon Fanshawe." And there was an asterisk, and I turned to the continuation page, and they'd written, "Because it would seem like eternity." So, I very much hope you won't feel like that by the end of the evening, ladies and gentlemen. The connection that I have, I suppose, with this is that I wrote a piece about a couple, an American couple whose daughter had gone to South Africa and was killed there. They were called Linda and Peter Beale, and she was called Amy. And I wrote this piece for, I think, the Telegraph magazine, and Marina found it, and that was how we met. And it's an extraordinary story like these are, and they had she had gone to South Africa on a Fulbright scholarship to work with women in the ANC on democracy. And on her very last night, she was giving a lift to two friends back to Kukulatu. They were going to change, and then the whole bunch of them were going to meet in a wonderful Turkish restaurant called Anatoly in Cape Town. And when she got up, dropping her friends off, she was caught in a toy, and the image, in a sense, was perhaps of the white mistress driving the two servants back to their home, and she was caught in this and killed. And a number of South African leaders stood up and said, you know, this was in the very volatile period between 92 and 94. And the astonishing thing was that when I went out there, that Peter and Linda had already decided immediately to go to South Africa to set up the Amy Beale Foundation. And when I first met them in South Africa, which through a friend, and then I ended up a few days later having dinner in a restaurant in a wonderful peach farm in Franschhoek with Peter and Linda and two of the four boys who were convicted of their daughter's murder. And they were then working for the Amy Beale Foundation, and they still do. And it was a story of such incredible inspiration, and they were great people. So those stories are absolutely everywhere. And just to flash on, lovely Joe Berry's in the audience. I live in Brighton, naturally. And visual clues all over the place. So depressing, it's not interesting any longer. But the Brighton bomb, of course, where Joe's father was killed in a bomb planted by Patrick McGee. And on the 20th anniversary, we staged in public a conversation they had in private for a long time by that stage. And it was extraordinary. We did it then, and we did it 5 years later. And the Forgiveness Project has had an amazing impact. When we first did it, I set it up. We had to do it in a venue that was secret till that morning. We had to email people that morning, and we had to keep it completely confidential. It was an invited audience, and I got hate mail. 5 years later, we did it at a public screening of a wonderful film called Soldiers for Peace, and we did it at a public cinema, and we advertised it, and I got no hate mail. And that was 5 years. It's an astonishing transition. So those are the sort of stories we're going to talk to, and we're going to hear Mary's story and Peter's story. But first, let me introduce Professor Simon Baron-Cohen. His interest is in the nature of empathy, and he is the Professor of Developmental Psychopathology and Psychology at Cambridge. He's the Director of the University's Autism Centre. And that is the main focus of his research, but he is keen to point out that tonight he won't be focusing on autism, although he may well mention it as he goes through. in a remarkable career with hundreds of extraordinarily highly cited academic citations. He's also developed software for special education called Mind Reading and an animation series to teach children with autism to recognize and understand emotions, and that's called Transporters, both of these for which he was nominated for a BAFTA. Last year, he published Zero Degrees of Empathy, where he set out to understand human cruelty and replaced what he termed the unscientific concept of evil with an erosion of empathy. To explain what that means at much greater length and to deliver the Fourth Forgiveness Project Annual Lecture 2013, Zero Degrees of Empathy, Exploring Explanations of Human Cruelty and Kindness, is Professor Simon Baron-Cohen.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation to talk to such an important charity. I'm not going to use the F word, forgiveness, during my lecture. Instead, I'm going to talk about empathy, and I hope that the implications for forgiveness will come out during our panel discussion afterwards. So I'm starting with a photograph. Here's me 30 years ago with my two sisters, Liz and Susie. Susie has learning difficulties, quite severe learning difficulties. She's the one in the wheelchair. And I'm starting with this image just to introduce my personal connection to people with learning disabilities. You might know that the UK government felt it was important to pass a piece of legislation in 2005 called the Disability Discrimination Act, and you might wonder why do people with disabilities need this special piece of legislation? After all, haven't they got beautiful places where they're cared for? But you can immediately see the name of this particular care home, Winterbourne View, that was exposed by undercover journalists, we all know, to be showing that the staff in care homes that look after people with learning disabilities were not showing care, far from it. They were using cruelty as a way of controlling the residents of the care home. The topic of learning disabilities and the violation of their rights has got a long, very painful history, a very sensitive history. In 1933, when Hitler came to power, one of the first pieces of legislation that he passed was the law preventing hereditary diseases. This is a propaganda poster from the new Nazi government in the early 1930s. Just trying to persuade the German population that the cost of people with learning difficulties, learning disabilities, was 60,000 Reichmarks at the time. So he was using an economic argument to argue for enforced sterilization, so they wouldn't pass on their genes and be able to, the state of Germany could change their population. During the Nazi regime, some 400,000 people with learning disabilities were indeed compulsorily sterilized. In 1939, just as war was approaching, Hitler passed a second very important piece of legislation relevant to this theme. It was called the Euthanasia Decree. And basically what he was arguing was that, again, in order to produce a better population in Germany, doctors should be required to notify if any of their patients had learning disability or indeed psychiatric conditions, and that they should be sent to euthanasia centers. Euthanasia centers, of course, is a euphemism. What parents were told was that their children were being sent there for treatment. But the decree allowed these centers to murder individuals with learning disabilities and psychiatric patients without parental consent. The individuals themselves were often unable to give their own consent about being sent to these centres. This is Hartheim Euthanasia Centre in the grounds of a very beautiful castle, the Hartheim Castle in Austria. And in the time when it existed, from the 1930s through the Second World War, some 30,000 individuals with learning disabilities were murdered there. The cause of death recorded was pneumonia. So the architect of this euthanasia program was a doctor. Here he is, Dr. Karl Brandt. He was Hitler's personal physician, so he was trained in medicine, but he was also head of the Nazi euthanasia program. He approved and also participated in the use of concentration camp inmates for the use of medical research in experiments. And we all know about his colleague, a fellow doctor, Dr. Joseph Mengele, who had a particular research interest in twins and collected thousands of twins. This is no longer about learning disability. Their status was simply that they were twins. And he killed them to immediately dissect them so he could look at the heredity of internal organs. When Karl Brandt was later put on trial at the Nuremberg trials after the war, he was sentenced to be hanged, and as they took him to the gallows and put the black hood over his head, he shouted, "It is no shame to stand on the scaffold. I have served my country." Let's come up to the present, because here we've got President Assad of Syria, shown here in a nice family photograph with his wife, Asma al-Assad. And you can see here she's helping in a food kitchen for the homeless. Seem like a very nice couple. But we know that these photographs were released just this year of children in Syria who have died as the result of chemical weapons under the Assad regime. And my final example is from India. This is Jyoti Singh Pandey. You remember her as the 23-year-old physiotherapy student who was brutally gang-raped on a bus in Delhi in March of this year. And the photograph on the right here shows her in hospital after that brutal attack, where she was able to identify the four rapists. And just last week, those of you following the news, you know that the Indian Supreme Court sentenced them to be hanged for their attack. So, as Simon mentioned, the sort of standard explanation for this kind of cruelty, which we can see across history around the globe, is that these are the result of evil. I don't find it a particularly useful explanation. Indeed, I don't think it's really any explanation at all. If you look at the definition of the word evil, all it really means is the absence of good. So all we're really saying is he or she did something bad because they're not good. It's a bit circular, hasn't really taken us any further forward in terms of explanation. What I want to argue for is that a more useful concept to understand cruelty, but also kindness, is the concept of empathy. Empathy is something that we can define, but equally scientists can now study. And you can see it's got two major components, the cognitive component and the affective component. Cognitive empathy is the ability to put yourself into someone else's shoes and to imagine what they might be thinking or feeling. Affective empathy is the emotional response that you have, an appropriate emotional response to somebody else's state of mind. So it's got these two distinct components, and I'm going to be arguing that when people commit acts of cruelty, for whatever reason, a necessary factor must have been the temporary or more enduring loss of affective empathy. This isn't a new idea. In fact, it goes back to the philosopher Martin Buber, who resigned his professorship at the University of Frankfurt in the 1930s when he could see what was happening all around him. But in his writings, he distinguished between two different ways that we can treat another person. He said we can be in one of two different modes. We can either treat a person as a person, which means that we're recognizing their subjectivity, their thoughts and feelings, or we can treat a person as an object. And at the point when we treat a person as an object, we lose our empathy and we become capable of all kinds of cruelty. This introduces a different sort of concept, which is that empathy isn't all or none. There are individual differences in how much empathy we each have, and it gives rise to this idea of an empathy bell curve. So most of us are just average in terms of the amount of empathy we have, so we're in the middle of this spectrum. Some people are above average, and we might come back and talk about them later. And some people, way down at the far left of this graph, are very low in empathy. And what I want to explore are the possible reasons, either social or biological, that could lead an individual to lose their empathy, either temporarily or in more enduring ways. So let's start with a social factor, and one social factor is obedience to authority. We know that Stanley Milgram's famous experiment at Yale University showed that you can take ordinary people, volunteers, and ask them to administer electric shocks to help somebody learn, and people will do this if these instructions are delivered by a scientist in a white coat. So this is suggesting that obedience to an authority figure may be one social factor that might lead us to hurt another person. A second social factor might be ideology. When the terrorists flew the planes into the Twin Towers on 9/11, we have to make the assumption that they were in the grip of a belief that they were doing the right thing. And although we can't verify their beliefs, and there may be all sorts of reasons why they signed up for this action, it's at least possible that holding particular beliefs might be another cause of losing your empathy. And this gives us a second example of how ideology might temporarily change your empathy, even in culturally sanctioned ways. This is Charles Davenport, who was the director of the Cold Spring Harbor Lab, genetics lab, in the early 1900s. A very respected geneticist, elected to the National Academy of Sciences. And in 1911, he wrote a book on eugenics, where he argued forcefully within the states, the USA, that there should be a eugenics policy where marriage between partners should be highly selected in order to improve the genetic makeup of the population. He argued for enforced sterilization long before the Nazis did. This is an image from the American eugenics movement, and a lot of doctors signed up to this completely normative ideological framework at the time. On the right here, you can see the map of the US showing you that 33 different states practiced enforced sterilization of people with learning disabilities. And here is Alexander Bell. Alexander Bell not only invented the telephone, but he was also the president of the International Eugenics Conference that was held in New York City in the early 1900s. And during that time, pre-war, some 65,000 American individuals with learning disabilities were given enforced sterilization across these 33 different states. So the land of the free, we should remember there is a history to this. Let's come a bit closer to home. We've already heard about Winston Churchill, but this was that when he was Home Secretary, he introduced a bill in the House of Parliament where he was proposing enforced sterilization. This was in 1912, for people with learning disabilities. It was part of the culture of the time and the beliefs of the time. It wasn't actually passed by Parliament. On the right here, you can see Leonard Darwin, the son of Charles Darwin, and he was the president of the British Eugenic Society from 1928 through to when he died in 1944. Again, he argued passionately for enforced sterilization of people with learning disabilities. So it's quite close to home. We don't need to think of this as in the Nazi context. And here is Sweden. We think of Sweden as a very liberal democracy, but in 1934, Sweden also passed a law for the enforced sterilization of people with learning disabilities. And indeed, that law wasn't repealed until 1978, to my mind, quite recent. And the Nobel Foundation, the Committee for Medicine, supported the building of the of this Institute for Racial Biology, where during its existence, some 65,000 individuals with learning disabilities or psychiatric conditions were compulsorily sterilized. So ideology, even in a normative framework within medicine from the early part of the last century, might be a reason why individuals might lose their empathy for others. Another social factor, of course, is in-group, out-group relations. This is an image from Rwanda, where we know that one community in the population described the other community as subhuman and as cockroaches in their propaganda, which legitimized genocide. So in-group, out-group relations might be another social factor that could lead an individual to lose their empathy. But these social factors can't really easily explain individuals like Ted Bundy. Ted Bundy was a student at the University of Washington in the States, and he signed up to help on a telephone helpline where he listened to women describing their difficulties and then arranged to meet them outside the helpline. And over a 30-year period, he committed rape, mutilation, and murder of at least 30 women. Because this wasn't a transient state of mind, but was an enduring characteristic, we have to assume that there's more to just initial social factors that might contribute to his lack of empathy. We can also imagine that with individuals like Ted Bundy, a psychopath, his cognitive empathy must have been intact because he was able to deceive others. He was able to imagine what they might be thinking and pretend to be somebody that they could trust. But his affective empathy must have been lacking if he could hurt them in these ways. The evidence that psychopaths like Ted Bundy lack affective empathy came from some research by James Blair in this country that was conducted at Broadmoor Hospital, where he showed psychopaths and then a control group of typical individuals three different types of images and measured their galvanic skin response, how much they sweat on the palms of their hands whilst they're looking at these three types of images. Threatening images like a gun, neutral images like a piece of furniture, and images of people in distress. And what he found was that the psychopaths only showed lower response, physiological arousal, in response to the images of people in distress. They didn't seem to have the natural affective empathy that we would have when we see that somebody else is in distress or suffering. Simon mentioned that I do research in the field of autism. I'm just going to briefly mention people with autism because they really stand in contrast to the psychopath. People with autism struggle to understand the social world. They don't seem to understand other people's intentions, their thoughts, their motives, and as a result, they often withdraw from the social world, finding it very confusing. And they withdraw into a world that's much more predictable, a world of objects. So they mostly have trouble with their cognitive empathy. But people with autism seem to have, or many of people with autism seem to have intact affective empathy, because when they hear that somebody else is suffering, it upsets them and they want to do something about it to show concern. So this leads us to almost contrast these two different medical conditions, that people with autism struggle with cognitive empathy, but their affective empathy may be intact, while psychopaths show the mirror opposite, that their cognitive empathy may be excellent, that's why they can engage in deception, but their affective empathy is impaired. Psychopaths don't just start in adulthood. They've often had a teenage where they've shown delinquent behavior or antisocial behavior. And John Bowlby, not so far away from here, at the Tavistock Clinic in Swiss Cottage, was studying individuals who had been in trouble with the law for delinquency and traced their childhoods back to their start in life, finding that many of these individuals who were showing antisocial behavior in their teens had experienced a lack of parental affection and a lack of parental love and warmth in their early childhoods. So one possible source or developmental cause of a lack of empathy might be a lack of feeling loved by your parents. But that can't be the whole story, because a study by Avshalom Kaspi at the Institute of Psychiatry, again here in London, showed that depending on whether you're carrying one or other version of the MAOA gene, that predicts your likelihood of becoming a delinquent in your teens as a function of whether you've experienced neglect or abuse in your childhood. You can see that if you're a carrier of the red version of this gene, that increases your risk of developing delinquency if you've also suffered severe abuse in your childhood. So genes and environment are interacting. Another biological factor that can affect your empathy is the hormone testosterone prenatally. Our research has been measuring the hormone testosterone in the amniotic fluid of babies during pregnancy, where women are having amniocentesis during pregnancy, where a needle is introduced into the womb and some of that fluid is taken for clinical reasons. And with the mother's consent, we've been measuring the hormone and then waiting for the child to be born to see if it has any relationship with their later development. What we found is that when these children are 8 years old and we give them a test of cognitive empathy, being able to recognize which word best describes what the person in the photo is thinking or feeling, and here the correct answer is he's interested in something, the higher the child's prenatal testosterone, the more difficulty the child is having at reading faces, decoding someone else's facial expressions to infer their state of mind. So this is a hormone that's known to influence brain development, but it shows us another part of biology that's playing a role or is associated with later levels of empathy. So far I've said almost nothing about the brain. Empathy doesn't seem to reside in a particular part of the brain, rather neuroscientists today recognize that empathy is the result of the functioning of a circuit, a network of regions in the brain. I'm not going to have time to go through all of these regions, but I'm just going to mention two of them. The first, shown in red, is the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, and the second, shown in blue, is the amygdala. Let me just tell you some of the evidence for those two brain regions. This is Phineas Gage, that many of you will have heard of, and he suffered a horrendous accident in the 1840s when he was working on the railroad in the US, and his job was to push dynamite down with a long metal rod. And one day the dynamite went off a bit too early and blew the rod up behind his eye and through his brain. The damage was caused particularly in a part of the brain called the ventromedial prefrontal cortex. Before the accident, he was described as a very polite, considerate, and caring individual. After the accident, he was described as someone who was very rude, very offensive, and no longer able to judge what was socially appropriate in different social situations. So he seemed to have lost his cognitive empathy as a result of this brain damage. I mentioned the other brain region is the amygdala, which some people think of as the emotion center below the cortex of the brain. John DeSetti is a neuroscientist in the University of Chicago, and he asked teenagers who were delinquent to watch short video clips where somebody experiences pain, they get hurt. For example, watching a short video of someone playing the piano when the lid of the piano unexpectedly falls down on their fingers. And what he was interested in was which part of the brain is active when we see somebody else experiencing pain. What he found was that these delinquent teenagers, in comparison to typical kids, didn't show the normal amount of activity in this part of the brain, the amygdala. Simon mentioned that some of our research has been trying to see if you can foster empathy in individuals who struggle to develop it. And this is our DVD, where we have actors and actresses showing different facial expressions. We've evaluated this in people with autism, who I mentioned earlier struggle to decode people's facial expressions, to know what other people might be thinking or feeling. And in the DVD, just some educational software, they can practice this much as you might learn a foreign language. And what we found was that when individuals with autism get a chance to be taught this explicitly, they can improve significantly in their ability to recognize emotions. So there might be novel ways to try and help individuals to develop empathy in those where it's not developing naturally. So as I want to finish on time, I just want to come back to this empathy bell curve, because we've heard a lot about individuals at the low end of empathy and the different factors that can push an individual to end up down there. But what about people at the opposite end of that spectrum, people with unusually high empathy? What do we know about them? Well, there's far less research about them, but I want to mention a couple of stories. This is Raoul Wallenberg. Some of you will have heard of him. He was a Swedish diplomat working in Budapest, and he died in 1944. And his story caught my imagination, because when he could see that the Jews were being rounded up to be put on the trains to Auschwitz, he climbed onto the roof of the train and pushed fake Swedish passports through the windows. And then he got back onto the platform and told the Nazi guards that these were Swedish citizens and they should be released from the train. And he did this time after time, and it's estimated he was able to save hundreds of thousands of individuals. Once he'd got people off the train, he set up buildings all over Budapest, flying the Swedish flag outside, called things like the Swedish Library, the Swedish Center of Culture, where he was hiding Jews who otherwise would have ended up in the concentration camps. So this is an individual who risked his own life for acts of altruism, and although it's anecdotal, we must assume that his empathy must have been very high. When these two men formed a relationship across the political divide in South Africa based on mutual respect, but also based on empathy. Arguably, it led to the end of apartheid. So people who are high in empathy can do great things in troubled areas of conflict. And I want to finish just by telling you about these two women who I met when they visited Cambridge. On the left is a Palestinian woman called Siham, and on the right is an Israeli woman called Robbie. Siham's brother was killed by an Israeli bullet. Robbie's son was killed by a Palestinian bullet. They could easily have fallen into the trap of feeling the emotion, the very understandable, natural emotion of revenge, which we know only perpetuates the cycle of violence. But instead, they both took the brave step of forming a friendship, again across the political divide, recognizing that what united them was that they both shared the same pain and the same grief at having lost a loved one. Siham and Robbie said some very, I think, very wise words when I met them, which is that the conflict won't stop until we empathize. Thank you.
Simon, one of the things that's always struck me about meeting people who've been involved in this kind of process is the seeming speed with which they appear to have made the decision to go on a journey which is not necessarily one of retribution or revenge. It seems to happen, and I'm sure Mary and Peter will talk about this, but it seems to happen very quickly. Whether or not the journey is completed is, of course, a longer question. Does what you're saying help us to explain that in some fixed way, people, by the time they reach some kind of maturity or adolescence, either do or don't have that capacity for empathy at a high end?
No, I mean, I'm an optimist, and I don't believe that people are incapable of change at any age. I guess part of the message of my lecture was that we should also feel some empathy for those who might lack their empathy at a certain point, for whatever reason, and might have done things that they later regret. And even if they don't regret it, we should examine our own response, because to feel that we should simply, for example, give them the death sentence, as we heard in a couple of cases in my lecture, does that reduce us to no better than the people we're condemning? Mm. Mm. So, but I think you're raising the question about when someone has done something bad, but then comes to want to ask for forgiveness. Is that right? That kind of journey? Or when they've been a victim?
I was talking about victims, but yeah. I mean, because I haven't talked to so many perpetrators.
I think maybe this will come out in the discussion amongst the panel.
And one other question is that this notion of the opposite, therefore, this notion of previously called evil, this idea that you could have a lack of empathy or whatever. You've ascribed certain kind of causes to that, and you've suggested that there's some social ones, there's some parental questions here, and then there's also some biological and also some neurological. Would that be right? So
absolutely.
It's those three components.
Yeah.
Does your research lead you to some notion, therefore, of treatment? In a prison context or rehabilitative context?
Sure. And I think each of those factors has implications for how we might want to intervene. So obviously the social factors might be much more amenable to intervention. Once we realize the importance of early parenting, for example, we should be putting a lot of funding into supporting parents, because their role for the next generation is so important. Mm. Mm. But even the biology has implications for intervention.
Because I remember the early intervention unit in the Blair government launching a report and Tony Blair saying, there is some reliable guide, sort of in pregnancy really, to what kind of kids might grow up with some serious challenges. And the Daily Mail, in its perceptive brilliance, had a headline, "Fetal Asbos." But in a sense, you're saying something quite similar to that piece of research, that actually there's a... I mean, it's breathtaking, isn't it, really, you know? You just love the kind of level... It's a Cambridge level of analysis, isn't it, really? But you're saying that there's some clues here.
Yeah, I mean, I think even the biological research might be giving us opportunities for anticipating which children might need more help and providing early intervention before we wait for secondary problems to develop.
Well, some more questions to Simon in a moment, but before that, I'm going to ask Mary and then Peter. Just really to give you a little bit of an introduction, a time to get to the podium, Mary's daughter, Charlotte, who was 15 years old in 2005, was stabbed to death at a party. And Mary's grief and life since then has taken her on a journey. And Mary, give us some more thoughts about that journey. You're not going to go to the podium.
No,
I've just realised.
I'm
waiting for the cue. And of course, you told me before, you're going to sit here.
Yeah.
Do
is
it.
That okay?
It's absolutely terrific.
Hello, everybody.
Mary Foley, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I had a daughter who was 15 years old. Back in 2005, she went to her first 16th birthday party. And unfortunately, she was stabbed by another young girl who was basically gunning for somebody else, but Charlotte happened to be there. They knew of each other, but they weren't friends or acquaintances as such. They exchanged words on the dance floor. Charlotte went up to the young girl's bedroom, whose 16th birthday party it was. There was a group of girls in there doing their hair and freshening up. And Charlotte came out the bedroom, and this other young girl who was gunning for one of Charlotte's friends came up the stairs, and they met each other on the landing. And they exchanged words because the music was so loud downstairs on the dance floor. The young girl who attacked Charlotte said to Charlotte, "What did you say to me downstairs?" And Charlotte, with her arms open, said, What do you mean?" And with that, Beatrice stabbed Charlotte once through the chest. She collapsed back into the bedroom, into the arms of her friend. And Beatrice ran down the stairs. She was stopped by her cousin. And she said to her cousin, "Get out of my way. Do you want me to stab you as well?" So obviously the cousin got out of the way, and Beatrice ran out of the house. A group of young guys chased Beatrice, and fortunate for her, there was a police car at the bottom of the road, and the police officer came out the car, put Beatrice in the police car for her own safety, and when the young lads got to the police car, they explained exactly what happened. And as you can imagine, the police called for backup. And that was it. I had no idea what had happened to Charlotte. She'd spend the weekend around her dad's house. I had no idea she was going to be going to this party. So I got a call at 1:30 Sunday morning from a young frantic girl saying, "You Charlotte's mum, Charlotte's been stabbed." And the phone went dead. I woke my husband up and I said, "I just got a call that Charlotte's been stabbed." And a few minutes after that, a police officer rang and told me that my daughter's been in a serious incident. They're coming to get me. They did come to get me. And within half an hour, I was at the hospital, and all I could see was all these young people crying in casualty. And I really didn't pay no attention to it. The police officers, as we was driving to the hospital, didn't explain to me or said anything about what had happened to Charlotte. So I got to the hospital in the waiting room around 10 minutes, and three doctors came in and said, "I'm sorry, Mrs. Foley, was unable to save your daughter. Charlotte is dead." And really, it's you would never think it would come knocking at your door at all. She wasn't in a gang. She was studying her GCSEs. She was a normal 15-year-old teenager. And it was devastating for myself, my family, my community, Charlotte's school. Everybody was affected by it. Went to court around a year later, and I actually saw the young girl who had murdered Charlotte, and I couldn't believe this petite young girl had done this to Charlotte. And what was going on inside of me was a lot of hatred, a lot of anger. And as far as I was concerned, I was justified to feel what I was feeling. I had all the right. Nobody could ever tell me anything that I shouldn't be feeling the way I did. But attending court, I looked over to Beatrice and I remember thinking, you are human, you are, you know, you're a young girl, you're not a monster, you're not, you know, you're not evil, you're not, you know, you are still human, but yet you've done this, how could you do this? So I battled with it for a long, long time, and then I remember the third week in court and hearing about Beatrice's background. She often saw her dad pull out a knife. She often saw her dad physically abuse her mother. She was a bit of a delinquent in school. She never attended college. All these things. And I started to feel empathy for Beatrice and understanding why she did what she did. Not justifying what she did, but it just gave me an insight into her as a person. Beatrice wrote to me a few times as well, expressing how sorry she was. In the first letter, the second letter was a 7 to 8 page letter talking about her family, her friends, her siblings. She wouldn't know what would happen if anything had happened to her brothers or sisters. And she asked a lot about Charlotte, which was really shocking for me. And then one of the most surprising things is when Beatrice wrote about herself, she sounded like Charlotte. The insecurities young girls have about their physical appearance and, you know, friends and relationships. And it was quite scary reading it. And I was really beginning to get connected to Beatrice at that time. And I remember sitting at home about a month later after she had received a 15-year sentence for murder. This word forgiveness came to me. And I brushed it aside, even though I started to empathize towards her. For me, forgiveness was saying it was okay. I was sort of judging myself. How can you forgive? You know, that's your daughter. You really love her, so you can't do that. You've got to, you know, you just got to just back off a little and just, you know, stay a little bit hard. Not too hard, but a little bit hard. But the more I entertained the word forgiveness, I felt this weight coming off me. It was like a heavy weight, because what I'd realized, I would have these crazy imaginations of setting Beatrice up in prison, you know, getting someone to do her in. And what I was realizing, I was no different. You know, if I would allowed that to manifest, I would have been no different to Beatrice. But then when I entertained forgiveness again and I verbally said it, I forgive you. I felt just a weight lift off of my shoulders, and I was becoming human again, warm again, kind again, understanding again. Because I went through a process where I was very quiet. I was getting very cold towards my family. I had no interest because of what had happened. And I remember when Marina contacted me, because it was in my local paper that I'd forgiven. I don't know how they got hold of it. Marina contacted me. She said, you know, would you be one of our speakers? And I remember my first talk in the prisons, and I was very, very nervous. But I saw these prisoners who had done maybe atrocious acts or terrible things, and all I could see was humanity in front of me, people who had made mistakes, people who had, you know, something had happened in their lives, you know, not justifying whatever they did, but I saw human beings. And I was becoming warm again, and I was seeing the impact it had on individuals in prisons. People coming up to me and saying, you know, you've really touched my life. And, you know, they started to say things like they were thinking about how their offense may have made other people think and how they felt. So for me, working with the Restore Project, it has helped me on my journey, and it still does. And it's made me remain human again and empathetic again towards every situation. And at the end of the day, I see it as people do have choices. Some of us, we do make wrong, terrible choices at times, more terrible than others. But you know, we're still all humans. So forgiveness for me is not weakness. It's contrary to that. It really is, you know, power. It really is strength. That when I forgave, I had control again. I wasn't allowing Beatrice or the situation to rule me and determine what type of person I was going to be. So, yeah, that's my story.
Thank you very much. Can I just ask you a couple of questions? One was, was you talked about your relationship with your family.
Yeah.
Did you all go along a similar sort of journey? And if not, how did you deal with the different stages you were at as you were doing this?
I think for me, my son hasn't forgiven, and nor has Charlotte's father. And that's their journey, and that's their choice. And I don't judge them in no way, shape, or form. But I knew what was happening to me as a human being. I knew how hard I was becoming. I knew how, you know, a don't care attitude.
Have you seen that in them though? And
I haven't actually. My husband now has come to that place of forgiving Beatrice. As for my son, I must admit and be very truthful, there is a sort of hardness there. And every time I want to talk about Charlotte, memories, whatever, he does not want to do it. He just shuts down. Hmm. But, yeah.
And have you, what idea do you have about why Beatrice wrote to you in the first place?
It was my pastor who actually reached out to her. And she had asked him, will it be okay to write to Mary? And he approached me and said, look, I've reached out to her.
And do you know why she wanted to do that? Because he'd been having some conversation with her? Or
I think it's because he had been having conversations with her, and she could not believe it. I think she was really surprised that somebody on, shall I say, my side had reached out to her.
And has the relationship maintained? Would you maintain that relationship in some sort of way?
Beatrice, the last letter she wrote to me, she was being threatened in prison by other inmates, and she was asking me for a lot of advice, what do I do? And I wrote back to her and I said, well, you know, just speak to the proper authorities. And she wrote again and said, I really want to see you. I want to meet with you. And I wrote back to her. This was around 3-4 years ago. And I said, well, that's fine. Just send the visiting order. And I'm still waiting. It hasn't happened. So I don't know whether she's moved from another prison or what's happened there, but I don't want to reach out to her and put any pressure on her, because I'm Charlotte's mother.
You want to reach out to her, but you don't want to put pressure?
Or? Yeah, I don't want to reach out to her. I could search if I really, really wanted to, get some, you know, people involved or some charities or whatever, you know, and find out where she is, but I think I wouldn't want her to feel pressured, because she's murdered my daughter, so, you know, yeah, I must see Mary. I think it's got to be something she really wants to do, and she's up for it.
Amazing. Thank you for letting me ask you that.
Thank you.
In March 2002, Peter Woolfe was a career criminal and a drug addict, and he broke into the house of a family of a London businessman called Will Riley, where that journey led to, and an event with Will, Peter's going to tell you now. Peter.
Can you hear me all right? Yeah. It's quite surreal, really, standing here talking to you. You know, it's 13, 14 years ago. I used to live in a dustbin, not your metaphoric dustbin, you know, an actual dustbin. And I make light of it today because it was a nice dustbin in Islington, and you know, there was
how a second dustbin in Wales.
However, it was quite a sad place to be. I spent 18 and a half years of my life in prison and committed every crime you could possibly commit other than murder and sexual crimes. I think murder was probably more by luck than judgment, if I'm honest. I was brought up by a criminal family, quite a notorious criminal family, so it was quite the obvious step for me to become a criminal. And in fact, I remember going to Ballstall as a 15-year-old boy and going to Wormwood Scrubs, and it was like getting your A-levels, really and truly. It was like everyone congratulated you, and it was something that that's what I got my affirmation for. I got my affirmation for doing the wrong thing. And I continue to do this for a long, long time. Unfortunately, during this journey of criminality, I also discovered alcohol and drugs, heroin, crack cocaine, etc., etc. And I'm not making an excuse. I still would have been a criminal had I not taken the drugs, etc. But this sort of compounded the what I'd done. You know, it was a desperation stake in the end. And I think listening to what's been said, you know, all of a sudden I've got this huge reading list I want to get through. But suddenly I realised, you know, I didn't really care about myself. So if I didn't care about myself, I was hardly likely to care about anyone, really. You know, because for me, I even though I didn't have any conscience about what I'd done, I was brought up. My granddad used to say to me, "Well, if they can't hang on to it, they shouldn't have had it in the first place." So that was how I was led to believe it was rightfully mine, sort of thing. So I couldn't I could justify everything. They're rich, they can afford it. It's only a laptop, or they're insured, etc., etc., etc. And I think I've started developing a conscience. I've got a brother who's a murderer, who killed someone, and when he done that, on that moment, it's like he died, do you know? It was like he died, because he got locked away for the rest of his life, and that was a huge blow for all of us. But for me, I felt terribly, terribly guilty, and it was the first time I ever felt guilty about anything. But I think I was probably feeling guilty that I weren't there to save him. And I think that might have been, looking back, might have been the beginning of the journey. In 2002, I burgled Will Riley's house. I don't know if Will's here tonight, I hope he is, but... And I burgled his house, and we had this fight, and I hit him on the head, and we fought, and he overpowered me. And sometime later, the computer of the Home Office, what was doing some research in this thing called restorative justice, spat my name out. And if I'm really honest, I agreed to take part in the restorative justice conference, really and truly, just to get out of the cell for an hour and for a packet of Obnob biscuits. But during the process of this 90-minute meeting of minds, of bodies, of, you know, it was a very spiritual thing. Something happened, and metaphorically what happened, I went into this room, and these people who had caused a lot of harm and pain said, you know, you've caused a lot of pain, metaphorically speaking, you've caused us a lot of pain, so sit down there and we're going to share that pain with you. And for 90 minutes they shared their pain with me. And do you know, I've got God knows how many previous convictions. I spent 18 and a half years of my life in prison. I think there's 27 pages of previous convictions. And I've been to all the courts in the country, and, you know, judges have told me I was a bad man, and my granddad used to tell me I was a bad boy, and blah, blah, blah. So I was bad, and I used to think, you know, I'll show you how bad I can really be. You know, if you want me to be bad, I'll really be bad. And but suddenly, I understood. There was no cult in the land that could explain this to me, that what I was doing was wrong. But these people who were sharing their pain with me enabled me to understand, if that makes any sense. It was like, I call it the 12-inch transition. I could stop trying to be clever and academic and put up the denial and all the tosh what goes with it. And it sort of sunk, and I'm not a religious man or anything, but it sunk 12 inches into my art. And once it gets into your art, things can never be the same again. It just can't be the same again. And that, for me, was the beginning of a journey of empathy. Yeah, I started to maybe develop a conscience, which was a very difficult thing for me, you know, to suddenly start feeling guilt about things that I'd done. Today, for me, you know, I was introduced to the Forgiveness Project by Will Riley, who, the guy who I burgled, he met Marina and suggested that maybe I could be useful in the prison program. And for 6 years now, I've been doing this, and, you know, there's something so satisfying about going into prisons and seeing that moment, the moment that I experienced, dawn on so many men. I've seen it time and time again. Suddenly the penny drops, and suddenly it's that thing about choices, what Mary touched on. There's 88,000 people in prison at this very moment in time. And out of that 88,000 people, there's very few bad people. There's a lot of people who have made bad choices. I'm very fortunate that I was given the tools to start making the right choices, and I'll be forever grateful to restorative justice, and I'll be forever grateful to the Forgiveness Project to allow me to do the work that I do. So thank you.
Thanks. So I'm thinking about what Simon said, and I'm thinking about this notion of, in a sense, learning empathy, Peter. And I wanted to ask you, when you said that thing about, in a way, everybody told you you're bad, and you thought, well, if I'm bad, then I'll show you how bad I am. Do you remember, though, at the same time as that, somewhere very deep in your brain or your heart or your soul, that actually there was a bit of you that was saying that wasn't you and it wasn't the person you want to be? You know, people say, you know, I got married and I remember walking up the aisle thinking it was the wrong thing to do, but still, was there that sense of it in a much... I'm not saying everybody does that, I'm just saying... I got married recently, so maybe it's on my mind. Actually, no, it's all good. But you know what I mean? That feeling that actually there's two things going on in your mind, somewhere there was a little seed of that or not?
There was a stage where I did have a smidgen of a conscience, but that for me was a weakness, so I had to squash that. And what I found fascinating, what was said, was I went through a treatment program in prison, and every morning that we used to go into this room and have a thing called a feelings check. And I didn't know what a feeling was. I really genuinely didn't know what a feeling was. And they'd say to me, "How are you feeling?" And I'd say, "Sweet." Yeah? And they'd say, "That's not a feeling." And so they gave me a feelings chart, yeah? And all these little caricatures of faces displaying different feelings. And I used to go to my cell at night with this chart and practice feelings in the mirror, you know, happy, sad, you know, so that I could go into the... and say, they'd say to me, "How are you feeling?" And I'd say, "Happy." Yeah, because I didn't really understand what the feeling was, what's supposed to have been happening. I didn't understand it because I suppressed that for so long, and it was a weakness. It was a weakness to feel.
So what was going on, though, when your brother killed somebody and you felt something? So what was going on there? What do you think started the idea that actually you didn't want to be where you were? You clearly saw what had happened to your brother, and you clearly indicated you wanted to make a journey.
See, I felt guilty that I weren't there to protect him, because he's my younger brother. He's, you know, my little brother, he's 45 years of age, but he's my little brother. And Really and truly, had I been there with him, I probably would have done it with him.
But that's a feeling, isn't it? My point is that something must have been waking up. And do you remember what that felt like to have that feeling?
It was difficult. That's what it felt like. I was scared. Once I developed a conscience, it was the hardest thing in the world for me, because, you know, I was a career criminal and I caused a lot of pain to a lot of people. And to suddenly develop a conscience, it's very overpowering. You know, you have to deal with...
Not to say career damaging.
Career damaging, yeah. You know, you have to change completely.
Yeah.
Everything changes. It's like, it was hard. But, you know, I wouldn't change this journey for anything.
And what about your memory of that first time you met Will? Because you're, I don't know if anybody's seen the video that Peter and Will did. I mean, you are absolutely chalk and cheese, aren't you? I mean, you could not, in a sense, have come from more different places.
Oh, you know, it's the strange thing is, where I was brought up was this one street away from Will. And that's, you know, that area of London, you know, you've got the poverty line and then you've got the have-gots line. And it's just a matter of one street. And chalk and cheese, it really is. But the bottom line was, we was the same. We was human beings. We cried the same. I remember Will shedding a tear. I can remember that clearly. I can remember when he described the impact of my actions and what it had had on his family, and how he felt guilty about my actions because he couldn't protect his family from someone like me. I remember it so clearly, like it was yesterday, that meeting. It was, you know...
That reminds you of your brother?
I'm not sure. I can't get too analytical around it because it's, I don't know. I can't answer that one.
Wow. And has it been a difficult journey, or have you found it actually a relief in the way that Mary was saying that, you know, taking this choice lightened your life? Or has it been a difficult, hard struggle, and is it still difficult?
No, it was difficult at the beginning because it was alien to me. But the longer it went on, the more I was okay, the more I realised it was okay to be okay. Yeah? Did you get that?
Got positive reinforcement. For
yeah. I think the real turning point was I was... I found freedom in prison. You know, I know it's a bit of a cliche, but, I stopped doing all the bad things. And I was in Norwich Prison, and I'd graduated from the programme that I'd done, the rehab programme, and they gave me a job in the computer room, right up the top of the prison, doing the menu sheets. And suddenly some guy called me, and he says, "Peter Woolf, isn't it?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "You know what, I really used to respect you." I said, "Oh, yeah?" He said, "Yeah." He said, "If you wanted a bit of heroin, go and see Peter Woolf, he'll get it for you. If you wanted someone hurt, go and see Peter Woolf, he'll do it for you. All the wrong things." He said, "But I respect you even more now because you're trying to turn your life around." Mm-hmm. And at that moment, I knew I was doing the right thing. I knew.
Fantastic. Peter, thank you very much indeed. One more question to Simon, and then let's throw it open. Simon, when the recent conviction of those four men for that brutal rape in India, and the mother of the victim and various others, and demanding the death penalty, and the death penalty being given, and that is the great difficulty with those of us who don't believe in the death penalty when something that's it. What happens when we suddenly go, okay, actually, death penalty in that incident? Is that what that temporary loss of empathy that we then have, our inability to see that humanity in them, notwithstanding this ghastly thing they've done? What's happening there?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, the parents of that young Indian girl, in some ways, are no different to Mary. You know, they lost a daughter. Maybe I didn't mention that the rape victim died. So she wasn't just brutally raped, but she died. And the parents, in that case, were calling for the death sentence. But you can understand it. You know, they were overwhelmed with anger. And, you know, anger drives this desire for revenge. You can't really see the perpetrators as, you know, people that you want to think about their feelings. At that moment, all you want is revenge. And it's part of our evolution to fight back. You know, yeah. Other animals do it, we do it. We are animals at a certain level. And the much harder thing is to do what Mary did, which is to try to see even a little bit of humanity in the person that killed your daughter. It's extraordinary. Mm. Not to give in to that desire for revenge, but to understand, is this actually a person, and is she, in this case, Beatrice, you know, does she have her own vulnerabilities? So, you know, I wouldn't have called for the death sentence because there's no coming back from that.
Yeah.
You know, I would have liked to see the perpetrators have the opportunity, however long it took, like Peter, to come to understand a little bit about what they've done. Restorative justice programs, I think, are really remarkable because they're bringing the criminal in contact with the victim, the perpetrator in contact with the victim, where they can actually, maybe for the first time in their lives, get a little glimmer of the feelings of the victim. Mm. And that was exactly what they did in the Truth and Reconciliation proceedings that Archbishop Tutu spoke at this very charity lecture 4 years ago. It was all about giving the victims a chance to meet the apartheid perpetrators and say, this is what you did to my child, or this is what you've done to my family, and let them just see it. You know, there's no guarantee that the perpetrator is going to change, but we might like to give them an opportunity.
Well, Sister Helen Prejean, who for ease of reference, Susan Sarandon in that film called Dead Man Walking, she was once asked, I saw her on television being asked, she said, why fundamentally are you against the death penalty? And she said, because a person is not just the worst thing they ever did. And it's the most perfect articulation of that for me. Now, how are we going to do? We've got a microphone. We've got microphones and stuff like that. Or people just, yeah, all there's microphones at the back. If you would come down here where you can see everybody. Is there another one as well? That's great. There's a question here. But is there just the one microphone? Is that what we're talking about? Yeah, okay. There are three. Somebody's obviously stolen the other two. One upstairs? Okay. Fantastic. Well, there's a hand up down here. I'm going to do... well, someone here, if you could come... Hello. Yeah, no, what you do is you look at me and then I point and you go to the person I point to. Is that absolutely fine? So I'm pointing at him. I know it's hard, but that's the way it works. Yes, him. Is there anybody upstairs now? Hand up upstairs. I'm looking for women and men, both. I'm not just going to take loads of men because that's always what happens in these situations. But anyway, you know what it's like. Us chaps, we think, well, we don't know anything. We'll ask a question. What the hell? It's a woman down here. Right, you guy. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. And then her next. Great.
Good evening. Thank you for what was very important to all of us, I think. You covered many aspects of the whole process. I have some remarks still. I am a citizen from Lebanon. I took part in the long civil war in my country. And I still would like to have the luxury to consider myself as responsible for what I did. I mean, it would really make sense if I was to say that I was predestined for that. But I think that at any level of the civil war, at any decision I took, I was the one taking it. Something else I would like to add is the idea of considering that everybody else is responsible, and I am one of others, and I am not so responsible. No, it is important to stress on something that personal responsibilities are very important.
Assad, can I ask you, I think people would be very interested to know just a little bit of the detail of exactly what, because you were in the Christian militia, weren't you? And just, if you could just give us a couple of sentences about the kind of things you ended up doing, the sort of thoughts you had about your enemies, that would be great.
I did anything you can think of, just in the name of my cause, the Christian cause, my Lebanon, the whole set of rights, if you like. And as I was responsible to destroy or to weaken the enemies, I had to kill enemies. I had to send bombs to kill other leaders. And I had also to take care, to decide for the fate of prisoners who came to our headquarters. Of course, I say that I was happy to say that I was not doing anything wrong, because I was only killing enemies. not innocent people. But at the end, when I look up to the crimes that I have done, and to the fact that I had played the role of God somewhere, I was sorry for everything I did. But sorry was not enough at a certain level. I had many initiatives of change who helped me to change, to become a better person, and to realize that I was a sinner, and that I had sinned on many levels.
What made that transition for you? What was the moment
of
truth?
It was
a very long and personal battle against myself, if you like, and the idea that I had to change myself in order to change my country. I could not keep my country, I mean, the way it was. I wanted to change it by force and using luck and fight. And this was totally wrong. One day, I would like to share this whole experience about ladies and their role. One day, I was at home, outside the Christian area where I had been. I had to leave, and my mom watched me leading a meeting about what we will do if we would come back to our areas. Whom we will arrest, who we will kill, what we will destroy, and things like that. At the end, she told me one sentence that I did not understand then. She told me, listen, my son, I hope you will never go back to the Christian areas as long as you have hatred in your heart. I did not understand it then. But God has His own ways, and later on I will still achieve that. Well, this is all in all what I would like to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'll look for, before you start, let's just look for somebody. Is there anybody over there or anybody, sir, in the front here? That would be fine. Anybody upstairs yet? Somebody at the back there, great. Well, this person here, thank you very much. You start.
Hi, I'm Holly Roberts. I'm here with my mother who does something with a forgiveness project, which I never quite understood, but she seems very happy with it.
I'm 20 years old. I've lived in England my whole life. I can't pretend that I've ever been in many of the situations that have been described here. So I'm coming at this from a very theoretical academic point of view. But one of the situations you've described have been individual case studies. And they've only worked out, and that's fantastic. But when I'm thinking about what you're talking about, I'm wondering about when the bigger picture does become important. Obviously, I don't think that people with learning disabilities should be sterilized. I have some learning disabilities of my own, and I'm quite like to have children one day. But when do you want to forgive someone, but know that if you try, you can stab them in the back, or that the people who you hope won't reoffend, or who have gone through a program like this and hasn't worked, won't go out on the streets and kill someone again? The men in India, I don't believe in the death penalty, but should they stay locked up their whole life for something they've done like this? Where do you draw the line between trying to restore someone or bring back their empathy and simply trying to protect the people that you love and you care about?
I mean, Simon, do you want to do that? And perhaps, Peter, you might talk about people who the program hasn't worked for and what you've managed to do with them. But Simon, first.
Well, there's no real panacea, is there, for rehabilitation? There's not no great immaculate conception. It's down to the individual, really and truly, to find their way out of the wrong that they're doing. It's a moment of realization. I'd like to think that everyone is capable of making the right. Most people, there are some psychopaths who can't make that choice, but everyone is capable. However, it's whether or not we, as a society, enable these people instead, because we can be quite brutal as a society and persecute people for their past endeavours, on and on and on. Sometimes we've got to take our foot off of that persecution pedal and say, you know what, things can change, but you're going to have to do something with it. If that person doesn't take that chance, we mustn't give up on them. We mustn't give up on anyone. You know. For me, I think, and I don't want to sound all melodramatic or anything, but, it's about love, isn't it? Yeah?
Simon?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is a great question. You started off by saying that you haven't sort of had the experience in your own upbringing of the sorts of really extreme stories that we've heard about, but you're asking, you know, we don't just want to hear from the criminals like Beatrice or formerly like Peter, who have wanted to make contact with their victims and understand and apologize. We also want to hear about those criminals who are showing no sign of remorse and where the Forgiveness Project hasn't yet been at all relevant, you know. And, you know, I think your question taps into a question I wanted to ask Mary, which is, first of all, I want to just extend my condolences to you. I'm sure everyone in the room does. But my question really is, you know, you were able to show forgiveness towards Beatrice, and it's helped you, as you said, to kind of lift a weight off your shoulders and rediscover your humanity. But she was also wanting some forgiveness, is that right?
Yes. Yeah,
and, you know, so how far can we extend this? In my lecture, I was describing individuals, some of whom showed no remorse, no desire for forgiveness. So, you know, I mentioned Dr. Karl Brandt, who was in charge of that Nazi euthanasia program, who went to his death kind of proud of what he'd done. You know, how far do we extend the notion of forgiveness? Do we extend it to everybody, even if they haven't yet sought, you know, they're not seeking forgiveness?
I think with forgiveness, for me, I saw it as a very selfish act, because it was me. I was the one who was hurting as well. I was the one who was contorting and having hatred and all these imaginations and what can I do to Beatrice. So even though I have forgiven her and she's accepted my forgiveness, I am not in control of her actions when she leaves prison. It would be very sad if she does reoffend and does something nasty again. I think you've got to look at yourself as a person, as an individual, and I think there's only a pocket full of people, I believe, in this world that will choose not to change. I really believe in the majority of humanity would want to change, would want that help to change. So how far do I extend forgiveness? I think I will continue to extend it as much as I can to that person, because it gives them an opportunity to maybe reflect and look at themselves and say, you know, well, if she can do it, then I can do it, or even tap into their own humanity or their own emotions as well.
And people do the Ian Brady test, don't they? They say, well, what about Ian Brady? And you say, well, look, the point about Ian Brady is there's a difference between being in prison and incarcerated, which is a form of protection for the public and punishment, but also keeping alive the possibility that at some stage he might be able. And, you know, I think people get very confused, don't they? No one's saying, when in forgiveness terms, don't punish.
That's right.
But also, it's a relief, isn't it? It's a relief to forgive. You know, as a kid, I was sexually abused by paedophiles in a big way, and for years I held on to that, you know, and for years I felt the shame for them, for these people. And it came to a point where, you know, I couldn't even talk about it. I felt anger and rage, and I wanted, you know, revenge. I wanted revenge. But eventually I got to a point in my life, you know, not too long ago, when I could say, do you know what? These people ain't really that important, and I can forgive what they've done to me. And once I've done that, and I just done that, I just give it away. I didn't want it no more. I didn't want that pain in my life anymore. Everything got better for me.
Just on that point, it might be worth, if people are interested in pursuing some innovative and radical stuff around sexual offenders, it's an extraordinary project called Circles UK that you may or may not know about, which is an absolutely remarkable project that attempts to surround convicted paedophiles who've come out of prison with what are called circles of support and accountability. And it's basically an attempt to... It's very interesting that how that works. Simon?
But just to come back to your question, you know, the alternative to the death sentence is that we put people in prison when they've done such extremely bad things. And as Simon says, we do it for the protection of society and to punish. But the whole question is whether prisons should be something more than just security and punishment. You know, the initial ideas around prisons were also about rehabilitation, it's not always clear that rehabilitation is being fostered. And we know that psychopaths who have committed murder, if they get that medical diagnosis of having a personality disorder, often they're not put into a prison, they're put into a place like Broadmoor, which is part of the NHS. So they're actually offered treatment. Even though it's a secure hospital, they don't have their freedom, but they are being given the same rights as anyone else who's got a medical condition, the right to treatment and the right to opportunities to change.
I think there's somebody, hang on, there's somebody at the back there. Where did the microphone go, you very kindly? There it is, okay. And there's one up there, okay. We'll go to the back first and then we'll come up there in a moment, okay. That'd be great, thank you. At the back there.
Hello, my name's Elena Noel from Empowering People for Excellence. Simon, my question to you, as someone who works with young people who, you know, take the life of others and do cause very serious harm in school, so they're being educated at the same time, and it's their external activities that have
endangered the life of others or ended the life of others. You said early parenting is critical, more funding is needed, early intervention before secondary problems arise. And I'm just thinking, a lot of the work that works with young people to stop that harm from happening, and a lot of the community groups who deal with restorative justice are actually in the voluntary sector. There is some statutory intervention as well. But in this current funding climate, and given the prison population, I recently done some work with long conservation about serious violence and, you know, offending. Just wondered what you were doing possibly to make those in policy decision-making decisions here the outcome and the effect and the impact for society and communities. And what do you propose, given that this issue is so critical to the health and well-being of communities throughout London and the UK, what do you propose if you were in a decision about funding?
That's a really important point. You know, charities often spring up to fill a gap where there isn't statutory provision, and thank goodness that they do. It's often through the efforts, often very poorly paid efforts of charitable workers, to fill the gap that probably should be provided by any civilized society. So we know where the gaps are in government funding, and they're all over the place. But the kind of programs that the Forgiveness Project are doing, I would love to see that properly funded by the government. You know, parents who are struggling and who don't have, perhaps never had the role models themselves to know how to offer good parenting to their young children, that's another point of intervention, and there may be some government funding for that, but I bet there's a lot more needed because of the importance of early parenting. And it sounds like you're doing a lot in the school setting as well, if I understood your question right, that, you know, schools aren't just there to teach the national curriculum. It's another opportunity for intervention, but that also needs funding.
Thanks. There's up there in the balcony.
Yes, hi, my name is Pete Miles. I'm a person of convictions, and I also was still in town for the Forgiveness Project. What happened for me is back in 2011, I was serving a 7.5-year sentence. Forgiveness Project came into the prison I was in, and for me, if it wasn't for the Forgiveness Project, I might not have been where I'm at today. You know, today I'm in a whole different place, and I'm a career criminal like Peter Wolf. I don't know if it's the first name that gets us in that position, but I've served time in America, in prisons in New York, Rikers Island, and for me, forgiveness was, first of all, about forgiving me. That's how it worked for me, because I've done a lot of junk in my life, and I thought I deserved what I had. So until I forgave myself, I couldn't do nothing for nobody else. And when I had a chance to do that was when I was in the cell by myself, 18 hours of the day, looking at myself. You know, I mean, that was one of the hardest things in my life, is to be by myself, with myself. you know? And I hear you saying about, you talk about prison rehabilitation, and I always believe that prison don't work, rehabilitation, there's no rehabilitation. And a wise man said one day, and that wise man was Peter Wolf again, somebody in prison, we put a prison program, and they said prison don't work. And Peter Wolf said, what is prison supposed to do? Well, prison is there to lock people up. That's what it does. So prison do work when it comes to what they're... Prison was invented to help people in the beginning. It was invented to lock people up, and it does that. That's when we come in, and we do what we do, you know? So, I don't know, I had an issue with my father, major issue with my dad, and I forgave my dad 2 days after he died. I didn't know he was going to die, but I just happened to call him, and anyway, and I forgave him. But for me, the forgiveness part was, because I heard the other lady speak about, you know, about the forgiveness. To me, when I forgive somebody, I'm not doing it for them, like Mary said. I'm not doing it for them, I'm doing it for me. And what happens is, once I forgive you, it's done. And I don't tell you I forgive you, I don't have to tell you. Because if I tell you I forgive you, then I need to ask myself, why am I telling you this? I forgive you because I need to do this for me. My dad didn't know I forgave him. I didn't say, Dad, I forgive you. I just forgave him within myself, you know? And that's what it was about for me. So, I mean, the forgiveness project to me saved my life. You know, I go to prisons now. There are some guys in there that might not get it today, this day, this year, next year. You know, but it's not about that. It's about just keep going back, because I kept going back to prison. And if the forgiveness project didn't come there, then I don't know where I would be. So, thanks.
There's somebody right at the back there with a red shirt on, just had your hand up there. Red blouse, sorry.
Shirt, beg your pardon.
Is there anybody else up the top there? Yep, okay, we've got, okay, choose somebody, you choose. I can't quite see because of the balcony, but we'll do, and then we'll have, that'll pretty much be it, I think. So, at the back there, here downstairs.
Thank you for all you said, it was really inspiring. Question for Peter about that moment, the realisation of the guilt and shame, and what I work with young people prevented. What support do you think is needed in that moment so that the shame and the guilt doesn't lead to a cutting off and refusing to engage with the difficult emotions and understanding what you've done? What support can we put in place for young people and adults going through that process?
Support is, you know, one of the most necessary things in this process. I think it's hard to explain what support, you know, because it's got to be meaningful support. That's the crux of the matter. We, you know, there's a lot of I'm not going to point fingers, but you know, it's not a job. Let's put it like this: it's not a job.
Yes.
I worked in part of Thames Valley for some time and had a good success rate with the prolific offenders. Simply because I didn't, it wasn't really a job for me. It was, you know, it didn't go from 9 till 5 because their lives didn't go from 9 till 5. I'd be there on a Sunday night or a Friday night, and you know, it's about caring about people, and that's what support's all about, caring about people, not just offering advice is one thing, but if you want advice, you go to the Citizens Advice Bureau. Yeah.
But interesting question about stop it turning in on itself, which is interesting. The idea that the guilt can, rather than trigger an, you know, an openness, it can actually trigger a... Are the techniques that you would use, are the moments of intervention, just little practical things that people might think about that you use?
But me personally?
Yeah, when
you've
just...
Well, you know, I'm a great advocate of giving people hugs. You know, that is... I think... Yeah?
Fantastic. Last question, there's somebody up there who wants to. Great.
Hi, yes, quite a dark issue, I'm sure you know about sort of biologizing and crime. Essentially, listening to you and to some other sections, feel it seems like there is a case you're moving back towards a sort of more biologized, more medicalized sort of view of crime and bad behavior. And I wonder what you think we could do to be more sophisticated about that today. And another quick question, which is about the relationship between sort of parental behaviour and black therapy. You're talking about that's, whether that's just a one-way relationship or whether you think there's some evidence that that's sort of feedback loop from sort of unresponsive children and then detachment and children and sort of back here.
Because the public is quite scared, actually, of, as you say, the sort of scientising of crime, if that's a word, you know. But we're just kind of Frankenstein, you know, it's all that.
Yeah. So thanks for sort of highlighting this, because it kind of it brings us back to the old nature-nurture debate, which I hope we've moved away from, actually. So I hope that you didn't take away the message from my lecture that crime should be biologised, because I was trying to show that you can see the evidence for social and parenting factors, but you can also see some of the new evidence from genetics or neuroscience for biological factors. And it's not that it's either or. There's a whole mix of things going on. All of these things interact. And as you say, that we need a more sophisticated view of understanding that interaction. And I think the second part of your question gets at that, that you don't just look at the parent, because the parent, him or herself, is responding to this particular type of child, and you can get a whole set of feedback loops, so that maybe you need to be looking at the whole family rather than a particular individual. I don't know if that answers your question.
Thank you. Well, there's more time to talk about that in the bar afterwards, in that classically British way. But in the meanwhile, if I can thank Professor Simon Baron-Cohen, Mary Foley, Peter Woolf, Marina for starting the project, to you for coming. And I know. And one final word, if you would welcome and listen to the chair of the trustees of the Forgiveness Project, which is what your mother does, by the way. Caroline Shear.
I want to thank you. You are our supporters. You're here. One of the things we do, I don't know if your jaw dropped when you heard from Marina about exactly what had been achieved in the last 12 years. It's phenomenal for a small charity, quite how long our reach is. And one of the reasons you're here is because in some way the Forgiveness Project, the work that it does and the concepts that it helps people explore has reached out to you and brought you here this evening. Outreach is an important part of what we do. And look at the result, look at yourselves. It's wonderful to have you here. We rely on you in order to do this work and to create opportunities all over the world, actually, for people to connect and consider the concept, the idea of forgiveness, the power of the idea of forgiveness. Thank you all, in particular, to those of you here who donate. You donate in a number of ways. You donate your time, your money, your energy, and your commitment. I've just said we have a long reach. We really do. We go to prisons, we go to schools, the exhibition travels the world. Marina's spoken at the United Nations and is either at every important conference on this subject or is quoted in every important article on this subject. And we could not do this work. This work literally could not be done without the donations that you make in those categories. We're a very small organization, and the work we do is done because of you. Somebody raised a very important question about statutory and government funding versus what the voluntary sector is able to achieve and willing to achieve in the absence of that government funding. We are suffering just like every other charity is suffering. And yet, in these times that we're all living in at the moment, we are the ones trying to pick up the pieces from the funding which is stopping from sources. It's stopping from government sources. It's also, in a way, being cut off from the usual charitable sources because there are so many more claims on the trusts and the other charitable sources of finance, which many charities, including us, have relied on in the past. So if you would like to think about donating money to us, and I am not exaggerating when I say we can only work because some people, many, many of you already do this, then you will find the details of how to do that in the leaflets on your seat. There are a number of ways you can contribute. There are one-off donations. There's also a very, very strong and growing supporters program, and you can find details on the leaflet on your seat or on our website. So please think about that. We are celebrating our 10th anniversary next year. We're going to be reflecting on how far we've come, where we are now, and what kind of animal we would like to be going forwards into the future. And we'd love to have as many of you on board for that journey as would like to come along with us. We'd love to have your donations. We'd love to have your ideas. So do think about, please, staying connected and in touch in that way. Now, we've heard a lot of stories this evening, we've had a lot of ideas, and we'd love you to carry on talking about those and telling your stories. A lot of good stories out there, I know. Telling your stories and talking about the ideas that you've heard up in the bar, which is in the map room upstairs. And so a last but a very, very heartfelt thank you to everybody here this evening.